Looking at a couple of technologies that we haven't really focused on yet today, fMRI has been one of the earliest tools used. The problem is there are a whole lot of issues with it. It's expensive, it's claustrophobic, very noisy. The subject can't move around in there, they can't interact with their surroundings, and sample sizes are incredibly small. So there are a bunch of scalability issues. It is being used in the academic world quite a bit, and they're doing things like object recognition, purchase prediction, and some of the results coming out of this are pretty interesting, but as far as creating a scalable commercial tool, fMRI is really not there yet. Just to show you what an example of what it would look like, recognizing that it would be hard to scale this to the level that most consumer companies would want. This is an fMRI analysis from MindSign of an Avatar trailer. And what you can see is in the brain, you'll see the sort of the flickering patterns there. And I guess the one thing to observe from this is that the updates of those color changes are pretty slow. The sampling rate for fMRI is not high, and the pixels there are pretty chunky. You're not looking at individual neurons, you're looking at pretty gross sections of the brain to get that. But then of course, the big trick, if you're a neuromarketing service provider, is to figure out what those patterns even mean. That's the secret sauce that they all talk about, and it's certainly questionable whether they all actually have a secret sauce that's worth sharing. In fact, a couple of years ago, there was an fMRI-based company that did an analysis of the Super Bowl ads and picked the winners and the losers. One of the bottom three ads that year, as far as their measurement of emotional engagement, was the GoDaddy ad, which featured the GoDaddy girl. I happened to find some ComScore data that showed the rise in website traffic for each of the Super Bowl advertisers at the time of the game and a little bit after. When you match them up, GoDaddy had the biggest jump in web traffic of any Super Bowl advertiser. So whatever those particular practitioners measured, it was not an effective predictor of business success because GoDaddy accomplished their objective. Now, there are reasons why GoDaddy actually tried to push people to their website more than some, but you really have to be careful that simply knowing what lights the brain up is not necessarily enough to determine whether a business objective will be met. EEG is probably the most common technology used right now for commercial neuromarketing. It's portable, it's cheaper, easier, you can get somewhat higher sample sizes. The limitations are that it measures activity only from the surface. Where the fMRI was actually looking at what was going on deep inside the brain, EEG is a surface measurement. In fact, one fMRI researcher out at Stanford commented that EEG was a lot like listening outside a stadium to determine what was happening on the playing field. In other words, not very effective. But then again, he was an fMRI guy. There are different approaches. Sans research uses pretty much a full EEG cap. Neurofocus has a somewhat scaled down version that's a little more friendly looking. M-Sense, a company that is of uncertain status right now, used this very simple little band with either a single or just a few dry contacts on the front. They're trying to address a scalability issue by pushing it out into people's homes where they could connect via their home computer and measure the response that way. In fact, they've run into some difficulties as a company, and as I say, their status is uncertain right now. Interscope says that they tested EEG in addition to their biometrics and that they didn't get enough additional good information from EEG to justify using it. So that pretty much runs the full spectrum there from none all the way up to Sans's full cap. And I was the torso model for that. We're going to take a quick look at EEG in action here from Sans. You can see the both EEG cap and also eye tracking device. This was one of the top-rated Super Bowl commercials, and you've got the eye-tracking hotspots going on over superimposed on the video. You can see the different areas of the brain lighting up, and obviously compared to the fMRI, the EEG is much quicker in response. And then the measures across the bottom there are two engagement measures. I think it's the first one is engagement, the bottom one is motion. And from this, and again, this is SANS's secret sauce, so this isn't necessarily a measure that's accepted by everybody, but this is the way they do it and try and determine that a particular commercial works. And hate to miss the conclusion there. Jumping away from the neuroscience tools, there's an area called facial coding, or some different names for it, that looks at people's facial expressions. There's been research that shows that that people's true emotions are revealed by fleeting facial expressions. So that if I run into somebody that I really don't like, but I'm in a social setting, I'm going to smile and shake that person's hand. But in fact, a skilled observer could initially detect a negative expression on my face when I first spotted the person before I put on my social smile. And also they could look at a difference in what they call a social smile, which is just upturning your mouth as, you know, when you're saying hi, hi, and versus a smile that fully engages your face. So they've got a whole bunch of these expressions, like 50-some expressions that they can measure. And they say that a trained individual can do these. To look at, this is another commercial here that we're going to see how the facial coders analyzed it.
Discover Aquafresh Extreme Clean. Its microactive foam gets into hard-to-reach places, seeking out sources of bad breath, even in the pores of your tongue, leaving your teeth and tongue so refreshingly clean, you can't help feeling a change.
Everybody want to go out and buy Aquafresh now? What they did was every few seconds they analyzed the expressions, and what they showed initially were that there were both high impact and high appeal at the very start of the commercial. But when you get to that next frame where those giant tongue polyps were on the screen, or whatever they were, suddenly, the impact stayed high, but the appeal dropped way off. In this case, we're not going to go through the whole commercial frame by frame, but their recommendation based on their study, they showed that people were having disgust reactions at that point, with disgust being a more generic sort of a term for something unappealing. They suggested that the graphics be changed and that part be softened up quite a bit to avoid that big drop-off. Probably the future of this, for scalability reasons, is some kind of automation. There are different folks pursuing this for different purposes, clearly, rather than having to train experts, if you could use an automated system to some combination of facial mapping and recognition to measure people's expressions, that would scale a lot better and could even be pushed out, much as MSense tried to push out the their little headbands.